I've often stated that I think that statins are over-prescribed, but I've never really explained why I think that, so that's what I'm going to do in this video. Stay tuned. First, I ought to explain what I mean when I say I have an opinion. Well, this is how I form an opinion. This is my description of opinion formation for the purpose of this video. You probably can't find it in a philosophy book or anything like that. And that is when we take statistics, facts, data, trial results, in the case of statins, that's quite often what we're using, and we take our personal values and we apply them to these things. We interpret these in light of our personal values and we come up with an opinion, which is a provisional statement of belief. Should be subject to change if more statistics come in, more facts come to light, our trial results are available to us, or our personal values change. Something happens in our life that says, you know, something has become more important and something else has become less important. We can change our opinions. So this is how I form the opinions for the purposes of this video anyway. Let's look at the medical professional's viewpoint on the use of statins. So we're going to suppose that there's about 10 million cardiovascular related deaths in the U.S. each decade. I use the U.S. simply because the data is more readily available to me. 36% of those could be avoided if each of those patients was on a statin. Now that is a relative risk reduction. And if you insistent that no, only absolute risk reduction of 1% counts, I think you've kind of missed the point. There is a famous doctor out there, I think David Diamond, who is pushing this 1% value. And in a certain context, that 1% value is correct, but it's not correct in all contexts. And I encourage you to watch it's one of my earliest videos on absolute and relative risk reduction. It's 15 minutes. I wasn't as good as editing out the ums and the ers and all of that in it, so it's a little tougher to watch. But you see my position on it, whether you agree with it or not, at least understand my position on that. I'm going to go ahead with this and say the relative risk reduction of 36%, 36% of these 10 million deaths could be avoided in a decade if everyone was on a statin, every one of them. So if we knew ahead of time who those 10 million people were and we treated them, we could save 3.6 million lives. Number needed to treat would be 2.7 in that case, and that would be each decade. Now, there'd still be 6.4 million heart attack deaths in that group, or cardiovascular event deaths, which would include strokes and things like that. But we would still be saving these people. So the standards of care we see out there, they call for patients with as little as a 7.5% risk, 10-year risk, to be treated with statins. Well, why would they do that? Well, because they don't want to leave too many of these 3.6 million people behind. If 3.6 million cardiovascular deaths could be avoided each decade, and we could show that through, you know, statistical analysis, the before and after, and all sorts of account for all the other variables, that actually would be an astounding public health success. No question about it. I mean, that's where they're coming from. We could prevent 3.6 million deaths from heart attacks if we could treat all these 10 million people. Problem here, though. We're currently treating about 92 million people in the U.S. alone. That's how many people are being prescribed statins in the latest figures, and I'll have links to the journal articles in the description for that. So, rhetorical question coming up. Do any of our viewers believe that one out of every four people in the United States, or presumably proportionally in the world, should be taking any single particular drug? That just doesn't pass the sniff test for me. So the approach they take is something what I call shotgun medication. Because in theory, to save as many people as possible, we'd have to treat everyone with statins. Absolutely everyone. Why? Well, because everybody has some cardiovascular risk, even if it's only 1, 2, or 3%. It's there. So let's look at the 3% value. Well, if we had a million people with a 3% risk, then 30,000 of them are still going to have a heart attack in that decade. Statins are going to save a little bit less than 11,000 of them. So that's where the medical profession is coming from. If we could treat everybody, that's why it seems to me, that's why they're always pushing for more and more people to be on statins. And the problem is, the lower the risk, the smaller the number of heart attacks that you can avoid, and the larger the number of ineffective and unnecessary treatments that we're bringing in. In this 3% case, the ineffective treatments are the 19,200 people who have heart attacks anyway, and the unnecessary treatments, the 970,000 out of that million who aren't going to have a heart attack anyway. So let's look at the flip side of that, the statin intolerance side of that. Studies that I've found estimated that true statin intolerance in the population is between 6% and 16%. And for the rest of this, I'm going to be using 10%, you know, a middle figure, easy to work with. And we have to consider that adverse effects impact far more patients than those who are just statin intolerant, because it's not inconsistent. I used to think it was inconsistent. We'd had doctors reporting 20 to 30% of their patients are having adverse effects on statins, yet the claim is there's only 6% to 16% of statin statin intolerance? Well, that's because statin intolerance actually has a very definitive clinical definition, which I'll probably have to go into in another video. But for now, it's like a subset of people who have adverse effects from statins are actually statin intolerant. In other words, if your adverse effects are so minor that you can tolerate them, then yeah, you're not statin intolerant by definition. So not everyone who experiences adverse effects is actually statin intolerant by the clinical definition. Clinical definition includes trying three different statins and being unable to tolerate the adverse effects on any of them. And in fact, even though for some reason in my records they keep on saying I'm allergic to statins, and I don't even think that's a term that has any validity medically, I'm actually statin intolerant by their definition, given that they tried me on three different statins and I had adverse effects on all of them that degraded my quality of life. So if we use that 10% statin intolerance as an estimate, then there's 9.2 million people out of these 92 million who are ultimately going to end up being statin intolerant. And in the U.S. population, as an example, there's potentially 35 million people out there who are statin intolerant. Suppose we lived in some kind of totalitarian dystopia in the future where everybody would be forced to take statins and you couldn't avoid it even if you're statin intolerant. Well, we'd be injuring 35 million people as we put everybody on statins, and we would be saving 3.6 million. So the question is, rhetorical question, is it any wonder that 50 to 80% of statin users quit within a few years? It's the adverse effects. There's a lot of them out there. So the number of people on statins is just overwhelming the number of people who could possibly be saved. But let's start first with a quick pop quiz here. If a study showed that heart attack rates went down, but 100% of the people who died of heart attacks were on statins, what would that tell us? Would it tell us that statins are totally ineffective and something else reduced the heart attacks? Would it tell us that statins are causing the heart attacks? Or would it tell us that we've actually properly prescribed statins only to people who will have heart attacks? Because nobody who had a heart attack wasn't on statins, so that means that there's nobody out there who had an untreated heart attack. Well, you know, the truth would probably be a combination of these three things, but that just points out how hard it is to look at data and figure out what it really means to us just by using our initial reaction to it. If we could do precision prescribing, it would be great if we could give this medicine to all people who are destined to have a heart attack if they were left untreated. And then we'd end up with that situation where, yeah, there'd still be a bunch of people who would have heart attacks and they'd all be on statins because through some crystal ball or something, we were able to only treat the people who were going to have heart attacks. Or even more precise, we would only give it to the people who are destined to have heart attacks but will be saved if treated. Now, we don't know how to figure that out, you know, and it would be really sad for the people who are destined to have a heart attack but they can't be saved because we would have to tell them, sorry, get your affairs in order. You're going to be gone in the next 10 years. I'm not even sure this is even possible, but maybe with artificial intelligence, machine learning, we can identify the patients who are going to have a heart attack for certain. In other words, instead of a 7.5% heart attack risk, 7.5% of those people would be assigned 100% heart attack risk and the rest would be given a 0% heart attack risk. So we could identify in all these risk groups who's really going to have a heart attack and who's really not. If we could further figure out which ones will actually be saved by a statin, give them the statins, hope they're not statin intolerant. If they are, find some other treatment. And for the people who aren't going to be saved by statins, because somehow magically we have a crystal ball and we can figure that out, try other things. We want to save everybody. We want to get rid of heart attacks completely. And this statin road is just not doing it and really can't do it. It can't achieve it completely. It can be part of the solution, but it's not the whole solution. And the problem is, right now, it's being treated as the whole solution. So what's the bottom line here? Well, in the U.S. anyway, about 92 million patients are asked to bear the burden of taking statins, and that burden is cost, financial cost, inconvenience, kind of minor, but it's there, adverse effects, and reduced quality of life from those adverse effects or from statin intolerance. And it's in order to save about 4% of these people. In other words, about 1 out of 25 people. So we're going to treat 25 people for 10 years in order to avoid one heart attack. From a public health point of view, like I said earlier, that's actually very successful. From an individual statistic, not quite so sure, and that'll be a topic of a future video. Medical community's response to this has been mostly to increase coverage rather than prescribe more precisely. Now, that's not 100% true, because if you look at the standards of care, I see that sometimes they say, if you have this risk, plus you have this condition on top of it, say a certain LDL level, they're trying to hone in and say, the calculator's actually underestimating your risk if you also have this or you also have diabetes. I don't know that that's actually a valid statistically thing to do, but it's an attempt by them to more precisely prescribe. So that's how I arrived at this opinion that statins are overprescribed. 92 million people are being prescribed it, whereas it'll be closer to 3.6 million people in 10 years will be saved from a heart attack. The precision prescribing is probably too idealistic at this point, but it's important to note, while this is a public health success to some degree, it's really hard to apply that to individuals, and I'll cover that specific subject in a future video. If you appreciate this content, please like, share, subscribe, and comment on this topics or others you'd like me to cover. And if you haven't seen this video, I recommend you take a look at it now. Thanks for listening.